gathering in order to worship a risen Saviour. So, if you're excited, give us a wave. That's, I was going to say most people, I pray to God it's everybody, actually. It is so good to see you. Who have we got? We've got the Nell family. Great to see you. Look most unimpressed, having been signalled out. Oh, no. Johanny's smiling. Who else have we got? Got Chris and Sharon there. It's great to see you. I can see Adam and Amy and James. It's great to see you. And so we're going to worship God together. Do you recall it was just over 12 months ago, wasn't it, that lockdown started? And there were all these rainbows that started to appear in windows with the words hope above them. And I can think of no better reason for real, genuine, eternal, guaranteed hope than the resurrection of Jesus. So Tracy's going to read us a lovely passage, a poignant passage from Matthew chapter 28, and then we will pray together and then we will sing together.
Morning everyone, happy Easter. I'm reading from Matthew 28, the resurrection. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the women. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead and he is going ahead to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." The women, ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy, and they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. And as they went, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they ran to him and grasped his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there."
Amen. I read that earlier this morning. I've never noticed before, but there's a word in it that appears on numerous occasions in the Bible, and it's the word suddenly. There's an urgency with what happened. And there's an urgency for us this morning that we would worship and praise and adore the risen Jesus. So let's pray together. Father, we thank you that we can come into your presence this morning without guilt or without shame, because Jesus, who lived, died, and the one who died is risen. And even now is ascended and is seated at the right hand of the Majesty in heaven, where he lives forever to intercede for us. And so we come with assurance, we come with confidence, we come with hope, we come with glad and excited hearts. And as we come into your presence this morning, Lord, would you meet with us in a very real and a very tangible way, in order that Jesus would again be glorified amongst us. Amen. Going to hand over to Joe and Gemma. Before I do, just practically, if you sense that God is speaking prophetically to the church or to an individual in the church, if you want to put that on private chat to me, then we will have the opportunity to share that for you later. So, Joe and Gemma, it's fabulous to have you with us. Thank you again for leading us, and hand over to you.
Nice.
Thank you.
We're going to sing that classic hymn, "Thine Be the Glory," or my words, "Thine is the glory." Whatever you sing, it's good to praise God with this song. And, you know, there's a lot of joy today. You know, you see football fans having a lot of joy and celebration when their team scores a goal. But today, we should have even more joy, even more passion that Jesus rose from the dead. So I want to see you guys really go for it, because today is a joyful and exciting day. You might feel tired and weary, but come on, church, let's praise him with a mighty shout, because he is risen. He is risen indeed. Come on. Thine is the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou art death has won. Angels in thy radiant roll the stone away. And the fading grave glows where thy body lay.
Get the
word,
please.
Yeah. Sorry. Though Jesus meets thee, risen from the tomb, lovingly he greets thee, scatters fear and gloom. Let his church with gladness hymns of triumph sing. For the Lord now liveth, death has lost his sting. Only the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou art death has won. No more we doubt Prince of Life, life is not without thee, aid us in our strife. Make us more than conquerors through thy deathless love. Bring us through the Jordan to thy home above. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. Thank you, Lord, that you rose from the dead. Thank you, Lord. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. And on the third and break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? But in the resurrection as well, that you bring life, life to the full, God, and one day we'll have eternal life, Lord. One day we will rise with the rest of the saints, God, and we will gaze upon your face, Jesus, gaze upon your beauty, your majesty, God. We will be like you as we see you in the air. We'll be transformed as we are resurrected, Jesus. Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Lord. Just encourage the church right now to just bring your thanks and praise to him for what he has done for us, whatever's on your heart that you're thankful for, but the most important thing is what he's done for us today. So over to you, church. You're going to mute yourselves and bring your offering and prayer to him.
God, I think that that's probably my favourite part of any of our Zoom services, when we hear God's people just giving him praise and thanks for who he is and for what he does.
We're going to watch the Easter story now and then hand over to Enidado.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to worship with you on this Easter morning. So the usual greeting for Easter is Christ is risen, and the response is he is risen indeed, hallelujah. Now I want you children to try it. Well, I won't hear the response, but say Christ is risen to someone next to you, and then you respond, he is risen indeed, hallelujah. Now, if you just saw that video, it sums up the Easter story for us, from when Christ started his ministry, the miracles, up to when he died on the cross. Now, this morning, I want you to think, what does that mean for you? What does Christ dying mean for you? What does it do for you? Yes, we know that Christ died and he was raised again. But what does that mean for you as a person? I've listed down a few things. Now, one, Christ dying means that God loves you because he sent his son to die for you. Now, he loves you more than your parents love you and more than your family could ever think of loving you. God loves you that much. Secondly, it also means that you are forgiven. Your sins have been carried on that cross and you are forgiven. Thirdly, you can spend eternity with Jesus. You can go to heaven and be with Jesus. And that's what Christ dying on the cross means for you. I want you to think of other things that personally you think it does for you. The death that Christ died on the cross does for you. I can think of you being able to forgive other people as well because you have been forgiven. The same way that Christ forgave you, you can forgive others. For our craft, I made this cross and on the sides I've written, thank you, and then Jesus in the middle. So you can make this cross, decorate it as you would like, but then thank you, Jesus. We're thanking Jesus for dying on the cross to save us from our sins. Now, for the bigger kids, you could try this. Now, what I did was trace my palm on a folded piece of paper. So here's the paper. I folded it in half and then traced my palm on it. Now, when you're cutting, you're not going to cut this side. Just cut around the sides where the lines have been drawn. And you should get something like that, which you can open up. But most importantly, write in it what Easter means to you. So I have written, God loves me. I can spend eternity with Jesus. I am forgiven. I can forgive. And then on the back of it, I've written Easter, or you can write what Easter means to me. So try doing the hand, well, it's like prayer hands or hands lifted up in praise, whichever way you want to see it. But write in it all the things that Christ dying on the cross means for you. Or you can do the cross, decorate it, and write, thank you, Jesus, on it. We'll be really pleased to see all the crafts that you come up with after the service. Now, before I go, there was some paparazzi from the church taking videos of as many people as possible, sending Easter messages. So if you were at home and you weren't caught at an awkward time, then you might see yourself on the screen shortly. So over to you, Sunny, for the Easter video. And bye, see you all later.
Love that, I think that's fabulous. Thank you for all who went out and distributed chocolate and all who said a big thank you on your doorstep. And just a couple of things to share with you. The first is, this Wednesday is the first Wednesday of the month, so we're gonna be gathering together for prayer. And so there will be a Zoom code that comes round earlier in the week, but just want to encourage you, there is so much to pray for as a church. We are needing to pray for the appointment of a new pastor, and the elders are in conversation with a couple of people, which is positive, long way to go, but just want you to know that we are actively involved in pursuing different leads. And the other thing is concerning a building as well. And so we hope be able to share some kind of update with you on Wednesday. But really, really do need you to join together and to pray. The other thing is that on Monday, the 16th of April, we're going to be starting a new Alpha course. Many of you will know about Alpha. Some of you may have done an Alpha course, some of you may not. But Alpha is intended really for those people who are starting to explore the claims of Jesus. And you know, and I know, lots of people who may well be interested. But the problem we have is that very often we don't ask because we assume that they will say no. And so I just want to encourage you, as the information goes out, to send it on your emails or social media, or even to ring somebody up to have a conversation in the workplace and to give people who you love, people who you are praying for, an opportunity to say yes. So we've heard a lot already. We've had that wonderful cartoon. We've been given a challenge by Enyedado. We've had a time of worship. But Brian has written something specifically for us this morning. So we're going to hand over to Brian now.
Thanks, Gareth. Yes, I've just written something for you guys this morning, as Gareth has said. So I'll just jump straight into it. We hear this story again and again, every Easter, that Jesus rose from the grave, that the tomb was empty. But have you ever stopped to think, what does that mean for you? It means life is more than molecules and matter. It means life matters and that you matter more than you'll ever know. It means there's meaning and there's purpose, that there's more to this life, that there's more to this world, and this world owes all its existence to God. It means our Maker is not uncaring and aloof. He's not out there somewhere with his back turned. He is for us. You want proof? Would the God of the universe send his only son, send a part of himself, his heart, to die on a cross if he didn't love you? Would he come to earth, gaining nothing in return, to live as a pauper, being jeered at and scoffed, staying silent as we beat him to a pulp, if he didn't love you? Would he take our place, take our disgrace, to stare death in the face and defeat it once and for all, so that we could never die, but instead be raised to life with him, if he didn't love you? Would he rise from the grave, meeting those he'd died to save, telling them it's okay, he is real? You can touch his nail-pierced hands, those unhealing scars that will stay with him for eternity, if he didn't love you. He came to do the greatest task that we could never do. You see, try as we might, we could never save ourselves. Instead, we blame one another, baiting out for blood, hating one another, just because each one of us is different. And when we strive to fix our own mistakes, we end up making more. So we build a wall around ourselves, shutting out our neighbours and whoever else might dare to climb the sky-high fences of our own hearts. But I've got some news for you, and it's good. See, though we may have closed ourselves in brick by brick until before we knew it, we were standing in the dark shadow of our own wall. This God who died to save us is the one who rolled away the stone. That heavy block that closed you in was burst open just for you, so you could break through into the light again. So come out of your empty tomb, the rock you've carved for yourself. We're not left in the grave, in the emptiness. The darkness of death is shattered. You have no need to fear, because Jesus died to take our place, was raised to life, so through his grace we can follow him as he leads us out of the tomb and into life. And back to you, Gareth.
Brian, thank you so much. That is stunning. Thank you. Just want to thank Caroline. I've just had a private chat, which reminds me that I've got the dates wrong. Alpha is not the 16th, but it's Monday, the 19th of April. And just want to encourage you kids as well to be taking up that challenge that Enyedado set. And once we've heard the message, we're going to come back and have a look at what you've been doing.
Okay, we're going to go to the sermon part of the service today. And this week, Gareth disappeared with his phone and a tripod. So let's see what he did.
I'm stood at the heart of Oxford University. I've actually been just stopped by a staff member asking me, am I with a television crew? Well, I'm not, but I've come here because I want to share with you from a place where some of the biggest and brightest minds have wrestled with the most intense questions for 1,000 years. Now, some of those students have been Christians, people like the 14th century Bible translator, John Wycliffe. Some of them have been professing atheists or agnostics, people like Stephen Hawking, the theoretical physicist who not many years ago wrote A Brief History of Time. And many of those students and those who have continued to do research after have made incredible breakthroughs in the fields of mathematics and science and medicine, including one of the recent coronavirus vaccine. However, I remain convinced that there is one question that's more important and more significant than any of them. And that's a question that concerns the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, one of the most famous students to have ever graduated from Oxford is the brilliant apologist and author C.S. Lewis. And Lewis writes this, that if Christianity is false, it is of no importance. And if true, is of infinite importance. The only thing that it cannot be is moderately important. And so I want to invite you to come on a whistle-stop tour with me as we examine events that took place 2,000 years ago. And once we've examined those events, we can press pause. And then we can ask the question of ourselves, and so what? It's now mid-morning. I had intended to get here a couple of hours ago, but I've had 101 things to do already today. There was no such delays for the handful of women who went to Jesus' tomb 2,000 years ago. Now, one of Jesus' disciples, Matthew, was a tax collector. He was used to keeping accurate records, and this is what Matthew writes. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone and sat upon it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. The angel spoke to the women. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come, see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were frightened, but also filled with great joy, and they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. And as they went, Jesus met them and greeted them. And they ran to him, grasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there." That's an amazing scene that Matthew sets. One of the problems we have, however, is that it's become so familiar to us that it fails to impact us in the way that maybe it ought. So let's just run through some of the things that we've heard again. While it was still coming light, the women went to the tomb of Jesus. People come here in order to lay flowers, to be thoughtful, to be reflective. There was nothing restful about that cemetery 2,000 years ago. On their journey, they experienced an earthquake. On their arrival, they encountered an angel. And on their departure, they met the risen Jesus. It's evident that these events would transform these women's life. But the good news of the gospel is this, that God purposes that these events would also transform your life and mine today. Can I share that quote with you again from C.S. Lewis? Christianity, if untrue, is of no importance. If true, is of infinite importance. The one thing that it cannot be is moderately important. What Lewis wants us to do is to examine the evidence, because if Jesus lived and died but did not rise, then he remains dead and insignificant and irrelevant to our life. But if Jesus really did live and really did die and really did rise, then this is infinitely important for you and for me, because the Bible tells us that he forever lives and forever reigns, because he is forever God. Now, many people have wrestled with what happened 2,000 years ago. Some people have said it was the soldiers that stole the body of Jesus. But is that really supported by the evidence? There would have been 50 soldiers who, if having failed to fulfill their duty, would themselves have been executed. I guess the last thing that they wanted was an insurrection. So even if they were complicit in some conspiracy, why was the body never produced? Some people, of course, have said, well, Jesus didn't actually die, really. Many archaeologists have dug up crucified remains. These were not people who were killed by rank amateurs, but people who were killed by trained professionals. These were experts in their field. Even before somebody was crucified, they would be flogged 49 times with a leather belt, and in that leather belt were fragments of bone and metal. That beating, the flogging, was so severe that sometimes even internal organs would be exposed. The condemned man would then be nailed to a rough wooden beam that would be attached to a vertical pole and dropped into a socket in the ground, sometimes displacing, fracturing bones. Jesus, the Bible tells us, had a sword that was thrust into his side. John, his best friend, reminds us that water and blood flowed out. John wouldn't know this, but we do, that after death, the component parts of blood separate. Jesus was dead. He was wrapped in cloths and laid in a stone cold tomb. This isn't the best place to convalesce. Of course, other people have suggested, well, Jesus might have died and the soldiers might not have stole the body, but actually the disciples did. Let's just remind ourselves about the disciples. They were led by Simon Peter, who was the bravest of them all, and yet, even having followed Jesus, he was the one on the night that he was betrayed and arrested who denied him to a servant girl. Were these fishermen really in a place to get around 50 soldiers to move 1.5-ton stone? Were these people willing to give themselves to a lie? 10 out of 11 of them were executed. Why? Because of their testimony that Jesus wasn't dead, that Jesus isn't an irrelevance, but that he was risen, and therefore essential for you and essential for me. So the question I ask myself is this: would I give myself to the lie that the moon is made of cheese? I wouldn't, and nor would you. Some of you might recognise that I'm at the top of Whitnam Clumps. This just lies between Wallingford in that direction and Didcot in that direction. And there's not very many people around today, which surprises me. However, on the way up, I've had a really good, significant conversation. This might surprise you, but I've been speaking with the Lord Jesus Christ, because I don't believe that he did not die 2,000 years ago. I do not believe that the soldiers stole his body or the disciples surreptitiously managed to get in and out with his corpse. And there are five things that I want to share with you that are significant, because Jesus is risen. The first is this, that his promise is fulfilled. In John chapter 10, Jesus said this, that no one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it voluntarily, for I have authority to lay it down and to take it up again, because this is what my Father has commanded. On numerous times, Jesus said he was going to go to Jerusalem in order to die, but that would not be the end. That was just a new beginning. Secondly, I believe that because Jesus is risen, then his sacrifice on Calvary was accepted. You might recall in John's Gospel, Jesus is quoted on the cross saying, "It is finished." One day I will receive a letter from my mortgage company, Building Society, saying that the mortgage is paid in full. Jesus was saying something similar. He was using a term from the world of commerce. He was saying that there is nothing left to pay against our sin because he has paid it all. And I just get the idea that when God raised his son from the dead, it's as if the Father was saying this loud amen that still echoes throughout eternity. A third thing I believe is significant because Jesus is raised, that I can be made new by his Spirit. Listen to what Paul tells the church in Rome, that the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. The same Spirit, not a different Spirit, not a watered down version of the Holy Spirit, but the same Spirit that was involved in creation is the one who brings new creation to your life and mine. The fourth thing is that is significant because Jesus is raised, that one day I too will be raised. Again, Paul says to the church in Corinth that we know that God, who raised the Lord Jesus, will also raise us and present us to himself with you. That's confidence, friends. That's such incredible assurance. When writing to the church in Corinth, Paul says that Jesus is the first fruits from amongst the dead. The idea is of a farmer who goes and takes the first sheaf of harvest and waves it and says there is much, much more to come. And you and I are going to be raised if we place our trust in Jesus, because he is the first fruits from amongst the dead. And the fifth thing that is significant is this, that I don't need to stand and look at God's creation alone, because I can commune, I can converse, I can delight in, I can rejoice in, I can share with the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm told here on Whittenham Clumps, Roman artifacts have been found. This was once a Bronze Age, an Iron Age settlement. And I don't know how long this place will still stand for and be a landmark for miles around. But I do know this, that the Bible tells me that the Jesus who lived, the Jesus who died, the Jesus who rose, and the Jesus who ascended will one day return. 50 days after his resurrection, Jesus came up a hillside with his friends, and there they saw him taken up into heaven, and a cloud hid him from their eyes. And there were two angels who appeared. And the two angels who appeared said, "Why are you standing looking into heaven? Because this same Jesus one day will return." And one day, and maybe soon, Jesus will return. And he will gather before him the nations. He will gather before him the living and the dead. I'm delighted that I know him. And if you don't know him, if you've never received him as Lord and Saviour, today, the day of resurrection, could also be your day, the day where you receive new life in him. And so I want to encourage you to examine the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. If Jesus was not raised, then this is of no importance. But of course, if Jesus was raised, this is of infinite importance. And so I want to encourage you to say sorry for the sin that offends him and separates you from a relationship with Almighty God. I want to encourage you to say thank you. Thank you, Father God, that Jesus came to live and to die in my place, that I might live, not just today, but for all of eternity. And I want to encourage you this Easter time to delight in the glory, in the truth, in the wonder of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ.
If you like what you heard, there are ways to connect to Ridgeway Community Church. You can connect by our website at www.ridgewaycommunity.church or drop us a message via chris@ridgewaycommunity.church. You can also join our virtual Sunday Zoom service at 10:30 a.m. If you have teenagers in years 7 to 11, they can also connect with our youth ministry. For more information, please drop us a message with details provided. We would love to hear from you. Many blessings from Ridgeway Community Church, Didcot.